Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Christina Moore, and I'll be your host. Today, we begin a course entitled The Art of Reading. Your professor will be Joseph Luzzi. Joseph Luzzi is an associate professor of Italian and director of Italian studies at Bard College in Annandale-on-Hudson, New York, where he has taught since 2002 and directs the study abroad program in Florence. He received his PhD in Italian literature from Yale University in 2000 and previously taught as a visiting assistant professor at the University of Pennsylvania and held fellowships at the National Humanities Center and the Whitney Humanities Center at Yale University. Luzzi's first book, Romantic Europe and the Ghost of Italy, Yale University Press, 2008, received the Scaglione Prize for Italian Studies from the Modern Language Association of America in 2009. It was also named an Outstanding Academic Title for 2009 by Choice. His articles have appeared in numerous academic journals, including Comparative Literature, Dante Studies, Italica, Modern Language Notes, Modern Language Quarterly, and PMLA. He has published reviews in the Los Angeles Times Book Review and Salmagundi, and he co-edited a special volume on translation for the Yale Journal of Criticism in 2003. His honors for work on Italian subjects include an essay prize from the Dante Society of America, a Yale College teaching prize, and a grant from the Keats Shelley Association. Luzzi has delivered over 30 presentations and a dozen invited lectures at a range of institutions throughout North America and Italy, and he was chosen to give the annual mini-seminar in Italian literature at Yale University in 2010. He has served as a reader for Harvard University Press and Yale University Press, and is a member of the editorial board of Dante Studies. Currently, he is co-director of the first-year seminar program at Bard College, a required year-long course for all first-year students that is dedicated to the study of major texts and intellectual traditions from antiquity to the present, beginning with the Bible, Plato, and Virgil, and concluding with Friedrich Nietzsche, Sigmund Freud, and Virginia Woolf. The first child in his native Italian family to be born in the United States, Luzzi lives in Tivoli, New York, with his daughter Isabel. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com. And now we begin The Art of Reading. Lecture 1. A Fig Tree of One's Own. The Worlds of Reading.
Pick up and read. St. Augustine. What does it mean to read? There is, of course, no single answer to this question. Indeed, rather than answer the question, I think it is more productive to think about it, its words, its potential interpretations. Reading, after all, is close reading. So we might as well start with a sustained and attentive consideration of this fundamental question. What does it mean to read? In the first place, the phrase to mean implies that we look to reading to provide us with something. That something can be many things: pleasure, knowledge, information, pastime. I could, of course, go on. But then again, none of the above captures the full sense of the word meaning, one of whose definitions is the intent to communicate something that is not directly expressed, from the Oxford American Dictionaries. To me, this captures the work of reading with precision. Indeed, we look to reading to communicate something. But the messenger, the words themselves, can be just as important as the message. In other words, the means of communication in reading is just as important as what is being communicated. Another crucial aspect of the question, what does it mean to read, is that last infinitive, to read. Reading is an action verb, something that in its own small way can change the world of the person engaging in it. To grasp this, all you need to do is look at the face and features of someone who is immersed in a book. the attentiveness, the palpable sense of a mind at work. Compare this to someone lolling in front of, say, the television, absent-mindedly and distractedly. Unlike TV land, the space of the written word demands our full attention and mobilizes so many different aspects of our thoughts, emotions, and imagination. In putting together this audio course on the art of reading, I want above all to stress that I will be describing an art, hence the title, The Art of Reading. This audio course will not offer any manual or techniques to reading. Other books and guides do this, and my interests and aims lie elsewhere. Principally, I want to take you on a tour of what I believe to be fascinating works of literary art and show you how attentive, engaged strategies and practices of reading can bring these same works to life. This audio course is a testament to the books that have shaped my own life as a reader. In sharing them, my hope is that their force and complexities will entice you to wish to learn more about them, perhaps read them yourselves. Above all, my goal in the course, in and through what I will call my primary text, is as follows. 1. Distinguish casual from close reading. What do I mean by close reading? No, it doesn't mean to bury your nose in the page, your eyes glued on the words, unless you take this metaphorically. By close reading, I mean that mode of attentiveness and engagement where the reader is in active dialogue with the work he or she is reading. Unlike the casual reading for distraction, escape, and entertainment, and there's nothing wrong with them, as I'll explain later in this audio course, the close reading yields interpretation. It takes you someplace that you perhaps never expected to arrive at. In a word, close reading inspires you to be as creative as the writer him or herself, and through a combination of reflection and imagination, to make up your own work from the original as you read along. 2. Understand the technical terms of reading. Allusion, echo, congedo. Now there's one I bet you didn't know. Anachronism. These are just a sample of the words, familiar and strange, that I'll be integrating into our course. As a professor of literature and thus professional reader, with a healthy dose of the amateur mixed in, I hope, I work within a technical framework and set of practices that I believe can enrich your own reading experiences. Throughout this course, I will therefore explain how and why some of these professional approaches to reading can be of value in the everyday world of books. 3. Think with literature. One of the most contentious and ultimately unsolvable questions in the academy today remains, what is literature? It's not just make-believe works. For example, Edward Gibbon's History of the Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire in the 18th century, a rigorous piece of historical reconstruction, is considered by many to be literary. And of course, it's not just works of the imagination in the strictest sense of the word. Plato's philosophy, Bacon's essays, among a countless list of others, have also achieved the category of literature in the minds of many, if not most, serious readers. So let's avoid this invitation to definition and taxonomy and accept that the word literature applies to many different kinds of writing by many different kinds of people. Let me ask a different, but I think more useful question. What does the literary text, broadly defined, reveal that other forms of writing, no matter how accomplished or impressive, cannot? So rather than ask what literature is, I am going to explore with you what literature can do. Now that I have given you a sense of these three larger goals and concerns of the audio course, let me return to a key word in the title. This is called the art of reading and not its craft or technique. I do this purposefully, because the process of reading I'm about to describe will necessarily differ for each and all. My way of reading may share some qualities with yours, but it will ultimately be as inextricably individual as my physical makeup or collection of past memories. This being said, there are certain common denominators, I believe, that many careful, successful, and even professional readers share, and I'd like to list them here. 1. a passport to alternate worlds. For many, myself included, reading opened up a parallel reality, a space neither virtual nor actual, but somehow with its own undeniable and distinct geography, culture, and population. My mind goes back to a winter day in New England when I must have been, about 11 or 12, and I flipped through a copy of Rabelais' classic text, Gargantua, to the section where the author describes the typical day of his protagonist, an imaginary giant named Gargantua with remarkable appetites of all kinds. In Book 1, Chapter 23, Rabelais writes of how Gargantua was instructed by Panocrat, and in such a way disciplinated that he lost not one hour of the day. And I'm quoting from the translation, both the title and text, by Sir Thomas Urquhart and Peter Anthony Motteux. Gargantua awaked, then, about 4 o'clock in the morning, whilst they were in rubbing of him. There was read unto him some chapter of the Holy Scripture aloud and clearly, with a pronunciation fit for the matter. And as I go on in this translation, I'm going to be modifying it to modern English a little bit. Later, he was apparelled, combed, curled, trimmed, and perfumed, during which time they repeated to him the lessons of the day before. He himself said them by heart, and upon them would ground some practical cases concerning the estates of man, which he would prosecute sometimes 2 or 3 hours, but ordinarily they ceased as soon as he was fully clothed. Then for 3 good hours he had a lecture read unto him. This done, they went forth, still conferring of the substance of the lecture, either unto a field near the university, where they played at ball, at tennis, and they most gallantly exercising their bodies, as they formerly had their minds. Now you can imagine the effect that this had on me, a boy growing up in a very traditional working and middle-class Rhode Island town, the child of immigrant parents who were themselves largely uneducated and non-readers, and whose daily struggles made travel to foreign places an impossibility for me. Yet here I was, back in Renaissance France, and a magical Renaissance to boot, a place where it was okay to talk about bodily functions. Rabelais writes with unblushing ease about gluttony, drunkenness, and all manner of scatological excess, where princes played tennis and read the classics, where bands of friends lived to read and study all day, where, in a word, Gargantua ne perdait heure du jour, lost not a single moment of the day. I think I realized then, and this feeling has never left, that literature and reading allow the mind and spirit to travel the world freely, indeed to invent and to invite alternate worlds. To my mind, the author who expresses this sentiment better than any other is W.E.B. Du Bois, a descendant of slaves and a man who eventually went on to earn his doctorate from Harvard and become a professor of sociology. Du Bois urged his fellow African Americans to study the liberal arts and read the same challenging works as their former captors. "I sit with Shakespeare and he winces not," Du Bois writes in his massively influential Souls of Black Folk from 1903. To sit with Shakespeare, or Dante, or Virginia Woolf, I have my authors and you yours, and we can fill in the blanks with any myriad of names. But whomever we have in mind, I believe that Du Bois's sentiment applies to all who love reading. 2. The Marriage of Form and Content. At the end of the Divine Comedy, written about 1307 to 1319, the pilgrim poet Dante is granted the extraordinary privilege of gazing directly at the Christian God as he contemplates his journey through 100 cantos of Inferno, Purgatorio, and Paradiso. There, in Paradiso 33, Dante comes face to face with a Godhead and the heart of the universe itself. He writes, and I quote from Longfellow's translation, "O grace abundant, by which I presume to fix my sight upon the light eternal, so that the seeing I consume therein, I saw that in its depth far down is lying, bound up with love together in one volume, what through the universe in leaves is scattered, substance and accident and their operations, all interfused together in such wise that what I speak of is one simple light." What is so astonishing about the passage, as I tell my students, is not only the poetic force of unforgettable images like the world translated into the pages of a book and bound together by love, but also the fact that Dante chooses the language he knows best, that of poetry, to describe the indescribable. The passage suggests to me that, for great writers and great readers, form and content are one. Dante's God is kind of a poet because Dante himself understood creation to be something composed or created, just like a poem. So the language of the poem stands as an end in itself, an allegory for no less than the making of the universe around us. 3. Humanity's Diary. In the early part of George Eliot's monumental Middlemarch from 1874, the young and talented Dorothea has just visited the desiccated scholar Casaubon, and against all expectations, she has fallen in love. Eliot captures this feeling that we know and cherish, and that we acknowledge for the pain it can bring. I quote, "It was 3 o'clock in the beautiful breezy autumn day when Mr. Casaubon drove off to his rectory at Lowick, only 5 miles from Tipton, and Dorothea, who had on her bonnet and shawl, hurried along the shrubbery and across the park that she might wander through the bordering wood with no other visible companionship than that of Monk, the great St. Bernard dog, who always took care of the young ladies in their walks. There had risen before her the girl's vision of a possible future for herself, to which she looked forward with trembling hope, and she wanted to wander on in that visionary future without interruption. She walked briskly in the brisk air. The color rose in her cheeks, and her straw bonnet, which our contemporaries might look at with conjectural curiosity as at an obsolete form of basket, fell a little backwards. She would perhaps be hardly characterized enough if it were omitted that she wore her brown hair flatly braided and coiled behind, so as to expose the outline of her head in a daring manner at a time when public feeling required the meagerness of nature to be dissimulated by tall barricades of frizzed curls and bows, never surpassed by any great race except the Fijian." This was a trait of Miss Brooke's asceticism. But there was nothing of an ascetic's expression in her bright full eyes as she looked before her, not consciously seeing, but absorbing into the intensity of her mood, the solemn glory of the afternoon with its long swaths of light between the far-off rows of limes whose shadows touched each other. It's the end of my quote. With exquisite delicacy, Eliot captures the mix of hope and fear, longing and contentment, unrest and rapture that fill the hearts of lovers, each of whom is different, yet each of whom is also in a sense the same. Literature, it seems to me, and reading to go along with it, can bring to life with such vivid color, texture, and resonance this ultimate human emotional state. For this reason, I believe that reading reveals to us what I like to call humanity's diary, i.e., it provides a written record of life's inner workings and mysteries, reanimated by the contact between the writer and the page. 4. A Fig Tree of One's Own. This last common denominator from the world of reading is, in my view, its most important. Simply put, I believe that reading changes the reader, and that the great work of literature interprets us as much as we interpret it. Percy Bysshe Shelley, in his Defense of Poetry from 1821, writes, "All high poetry is infinite. It is as the first acorn, which contained all oaks potentially. Veil after veil may be undrawn, in the inmost naked beauty of the meaning never exposed. A great poem is a fountain, forever overflowing with the waters of wisdom and delight. And after one person in one age has exhausted all its divine effluence, which their particular relations enable them to share, another and yet another succeeds, and new relations are ever developed, the source of an unforeseen and an unconceived delight." End quote. Shelley's words capture how, when we read a powerful piece of writing, we are taking part in a saga of the generations. We read and find meaning in the text just as others have done before us and will do after us. The literary work and the act of reading are located in the flow of human time, which is never fixed and always changing. And so will the interpretations we generate from these works differ from one generation to the next. A powerful work by the literary critic Terry Eagleton comes to mind when he writes that the term literature suggests a highly unstable and endless series of judgments by different social groups that demarcate some works as literary and others as not. Eagleton says, why does this happen? Why do we value some works as literature and others not? Can we sort of define the literary? Let's see what he says. He writes that, quote, the so-called literary canon has to be recognized as a construct. There is no such thing as a literary work or tradition which is valuable in itself. Value is a transitive term. It means whatever is valued by certain people in specific situations, according to particular criteria and in the light of given purposes. This is from his book, Literary Theory, an Introduction. Indeed, he continues, we may one day live in a world where Shakespeare holds as little value as graffiti. Now, Eagleton's common sense observation recalls the more ominous connection between thought and value, literary and otherwise, in Friedrich Nietzsche, who uses an explicitly economic rhetoric to diagnose the birth of modern morality. Nietzsche writes, setting prices, determining values, contriving equivalences, exchanging, these preoccupied the earliest thinking of man to so great an extent that in a certain sense they constitute thinking as such. Perhaps our word man, from manas, still expresses something of precisely this feeling of self-satisfaction. Man designated himself as the creature that measures values, evaluates and measures, as the valuating animal as such. That's from The Genealogy of Morals, translated by Kaufman. The remarks of Eagleton and Nietzsche return to my original question, what is reading? Because they reveal that even the work of angels, the establishment of moral codes, the designation of great literature, occurs in a world of space and time, of limited resources where we choose to invest in some things, our time and texts, and not in others. If we accept that reading takes place in human space and time, we might also push this a bit further into what I would call the conversionary space. That area in human space and time, again, in and through the encounter with a literary work where a book can change our lives. Yes, the meaning of a text, as Shelley reminds us, may change from one age to another. This also means that the reader, him or herself, may change in relation to a text, and that words that meant one thing to us at one point in our lives can mean another at a different time. Let me illustrate this by discussing one of the most famous scenes in world literature, the celebrated fig tree sequence in St. Augustine's Confessions, and that's the epigraph to this lecture. Pick up and read. The Confessions were written in 397. Now, many recognize this title as arguably the first autobiography, and it would be impossible to overstate the originality and influence of the book. In the Greco-Roman literature that preceded Augustine, one finds autobiographical writings, but they are generally in fragmented lyrical form, and there is very little in the way of sustained self-representation. Closer to his own day, Augustine lived from 354 to 430. The Bishop of Hippo, as he was called, he was a high-ranking member of the Catholic Church, Augustine would have had access to a wealth of personal narratives, mostly by saints, that described their path to salvation. But the Confessions is something radically different and well-nigh explodes the limitations of the traditional spiritual autobiography. This complicated text narrates the tortured process by which Augustine cast off his sinful ways, his addiction to earthly glory as a leading intellectual and professor of rhetoric, his love of the Greco-Roman pagan world, and especially his attachment to the joys of the flesh. Along the way, it provides a rich portrait of the competing religious doctrines, Christian and otherwise, swirling about in Augustine's day. It provides philosophical meditations on matters ranging from human language and memory to the nature of lust and desire. And it gives us a subtle anatomy of the human emotions that accompany both faith and our innate desire to gain knowledge of the world, even and especially when this knowledge comes into conflict with our religious yearnings. At a key moment in the Confessions, Augustine has hit rock bottom. He cannot seem to shake off the shackles of lust. He continues to enjoy the perks and vanities associated with his celebrated intellectual and professional successes, and his relationship to God remains a fraught and anxious one. Then something miraculous happens. I'm going to read to you now from the Confessions, the translation by Chadwick. As I was saying this and weeping in the bitter agony of my heart, suddenly I heard a voice from the nearby house, chanting as if it might be a boy or a girl, I do not know which, saying and repeating over and over again, pick up and read, pick up and read. At once my countenance changed, and I began to think intently whether there might be some sort of children's game in which such a chant is used. But I could not remember having heard of one. I checked the flood of tears and stood up. I interpreted it solely as a divine command to me to open the book and read the first chapter I might find. For I had heard how Antony happened to be present at the gospel reading and took it as an admonition addressed himself when the words were read, go, sell all you have, give to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me. Matthew 19:21. By such an inspired utterance, he was immediately converted to you, Psalms 50:15. So I hurried back to the place where my friend Alypius was sitting. There I had put down the book of the apostle when I got up. I seized it, opened it, and in silence read the first passage on which my eyes lit. Quote, not in riots and drunken parties, not in eroticism and indecencies, not in strife and rivalry, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in its lusts. Romans 13:13-14. I neither wished nor needed to read further. At once, with the last words of this sentence, it was as if a light of relief from all anxiety flooded into my heart. All the shadows of doubt were dispelled. Tole, legge, that's the Latin. Pick up and read. Pick up and read. Did it actually happen this way? Who knows? Does it matter ultimately? Not necessarily so, if we think about it from the perspective of the history of reading. What does matter, and which brings me now to the conclusion of these four common denominators of reading, is that, like Augustine, reading can give us all a fig tree of our own. A place of intimate contact between the text and the mind of an author, where a single word, sentence, or image can change our lives forever, lay our souls bare. Augustine could not get to this magical space on his own. He was, at this point in his life, as I read to you, weeping, and he was filled with bitter contrition in his heart. It took a series of random events, the voice of children playing in the courtyard nearby, the flipping to an unknown section of the Bible, for the longed-for break with his burdensome conscience to occur. It took a series of words from a book, and I'll repeat them to you. Not in riots and drunken parties, not in eroticism and indecencies, not in strife and rivalry, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in its lusts. Many things can change our lives. An accident, an unexpected phone call, a chance encounter, and so on. But so can books, especially when we believe in their power. And here, Augustine, a man of Christian but also literary faith, found an answer to his problems within the confines of a page. Now that I have spoken to you about Augustine's pick-up-and-read moment and religious conversion that it occasioned, I'd like to close our first lecture by speaking about what I will call the conversionary space of literature writ large. In the Oxford American Dictionaries, we find conversion defined as, quote, the fact of changing one's religion or beliefs, or the action of persuading someone else to change theirs, as in, my conversion to the Catholic faith is the example they used. Now, this standard definition certainly applies to the kind of spiritual awakening that occurs in and through the reading process in Augustine's Confessions. In fact, literary history is rife with many such moments that narrate, with intense psychological scrutiny, the ways in which an individual comes to embrace a new faith and with it a new identity. For example, in Dante's Divine Comedy, during the second canticle, Purgatory, Dante finally comes face to face with his beloved muse Beatrice after some 64 cantos, roughly two-thirds of the poem. But a surprising thing occurs. Beatrice is actually rather mean to Dante. After he tells her, in effect, how much he loves and has always loved her, Beatrice announces basically that Dante in his new life was potentially so capable of doing good things that he should have come to marvelous ends. But, she writes, as we see in soil, that when it's richer and vigorous, if it's planted poorly, it will go to seed. It will become wild, and it will become noxious even. Harsh words, but how do they relate to our course on reading? Well, what Beatrice does here is essentially rewrite the plot of Dante's earlier text, the Vita Nuova, or New Life, written in about 1295. She does this in such a way as to point out to Dante his spiritual shortcomings in that earlier work, and by extension, his earlier self. This occurs in and through reading because it demonstrates Dante's capacity to reread his own work with the passing of time and assign a new, even negative meaning to it. The scene is both a literary and spiritual conversion because in recasting the Vita Nuova, Beatrice rewrites Dante's spiritual autobiography. Indeed, his entire confession scene here in Purgatorio 30. Simply put, Dante cannot transition from hell and purgatory to heaven unless he is honest with himself, which means accepting what his Beatrice says was his earlier life, his new life, his Vita Nuova. After she finishes verbally skewering him, Beatrice relents and asks Dante if he is ready to confess his own guilt. She tells him, tell me, say, if what I'm saying is true, you must add your own confession to these accusations of mine. Dante answers, si, yes, in line 14 of the next canto, Purgatorio 31. It's a sparse, but I think extremely eloquent answer, for it signals Dante's acceptance of a divine love that trumps his earlier misguided devotion to Beatrice, which was based on carnal reasons and things like her beauty without taking into account her spiritual transformation she had gone into after her death. Now ready for heaven, Dante can slowly begin to contemplate the divine Beatrice's surpassing beauty. He has found his literary fig tree. He has come to terms with the true nature of his Beatrice, and his conversionary reading space in the plush confines of the earthly paradise, a replica of sorts of the Garden of Eden, reveals to us the way in which a new understanding of a literary work from the past can occasion a spiritual rebirth. Now let's fast forward several hundred years to less spiritual and more secular grounds. In Charles Dickens' 19th century classic, Great Expectations, the protagonist Pip has come into what he calls his property, an unexpected sponsorship by an anonymous benefactor who has established a trust that allows Pip to cast off his blacksmith's rags and become a gentleman. This book narrates a conversion of sorts, but it is one wholly devoid of any transcendental or biblical rhetoric. Simply put, the cash gift from Pip's benefactor, he thinks it's from an eccentric rich woman in a nearby town, when it is actually the behest of a former convict, Magwitch, whom Pip once aided during one of his early attempts to escape. It is this cash behest that allows the boy and then young man to swap identities with his former self. Whereas Pip was once a relatively happy boy living with an overbearing sister and her generous-hearted husband, Joe Gargery, he eventually goes to the great metropolis of London in fancy clothes and lives in what will become a well-appointed flat. Yet he is most unhappy because of the changes. Something in his heart rankles him. Where did the money come from? Why does he treat Joe so cruelly after he comes into his fortune? Why won't the cruel woman that he loves, Estella, reciprocate his feelings? He knows that all this money and property has changed his behavior and that a new relentless and ongoing anxiety have set in. Indeed, the middle section of this sprawling novel, which Dickens published in serial form, speaks of a young man who has lost his moral traction in the world. Once naturally kind-hearted and open, Pip has become increasingly abrasive and suspicious. And nowhere does his property-induced petulance and short-sightedness become more apparent than in his dealings with Joe and Biddy, the woman who helps and eventually becomes the companion of Joe, after Joe's wife and Pip's sister, the once ferocious Mrs. Gargery, falls into a vegetable-like convalescence. She's brutally beaten by an intruder in an episode from Pip's youth. Years after her injury and then eventual convalescence, and while Pip is enjoying the fruits, at least financial, of his newfound status as gentleman, he receives the simple stark announcement that his sister, Mrs. Joe Gargery, had departed this life on Monday last at 20 minutes past 6 in the evening, and that Pip's attendance was, quote, requested at the interment on Monday next at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Dutifully, Pip returns to his marshland hometown and performs his brotherly functions. Now, before we continue, we should emphasize that Pip's sister, before her injury, was, as I suggested earlier, a mean-spirited, violent woman who played the martyr to the extreme, reminding everyone how she brought up her nephew Pip by hand, the phrase she uses. And she actually regularly beat him and her husband, the lovable Joe. The beating that she received by the intruder reduced her to inactivity and largely silence, and her once fierce nature became docile to the extreme. Pip, upon returning for the funeral, asked Biddy, his sister's caretaker, the details of her demise. Biddy responds memorably. And now I'll read to you the quotation. Pip says, "I have not heard the particulars of my sister's death, Biddy." And Biddy replies, "They are very slight, poor thing. She had been in one of her bad states, though they had got better of late, rather than worse, for 4 days, when she came out of it in the evening, just at tea time, and said quite plainly, 'Joe.' As she had never said any word for a long while, I ran in and fetched Mr. Gargery from the forge. She made signs to me that she wanted him to sit down close to her, and wanted me to put her arms around his neck. So I put them round his neck, and she laid her head down on his shoulder, quite content and satisfied. And so she presently said, 'Joe,' again, and once, 'Pardon,' and once, 'Pip.' And so she never lifted her head up any more, and it was just an hour later when we laid it down on her own bed, because we found she was gone." Extraordinary. A woman who was once initially cruel and petty, and then reduced to an extreme state of convalescence, suddenly has this opening in her conscience, I am tempted to say soul, and announces to Biddy that her Joe, her beloved Joe, we now learn, is to forgive Pip. An unforeseen act of boundless generosity in her is thus her last earthly endeavor. Her act, I believe, is the ultimate example of what I will call the conversionary space of literature, a space where the unexpected and remarkable occurs on the page before us, to redefine a person, event, or concept that we thought we had figured out. A space where, just like Augustine under the fig tree, something occurs that sets us on a new course forever. What makes the event doubly extraordinary is that it reveals how Pip's sister had been aware of what has been happening all along. She knows that Pip has been acting poorly, that he has been betraying the person, Joe, who loves him best of all. So although we suspect her to have been whiling away in a trance all those years, she has actually been keeping a watchful eye on all that surrounds her, and especially her husband and nephew, the two that she treated with the most harshness in her earlier life. I call such events examples of literature's conversionary space because they provide us with startling narratives of sudden change and, more important, deep wisdom. Who would have ever thought that a character so seemingly mean-spirited and then physically impaired as Mrs. Joe Gargery could, in her final act, leave us with a legacy of unanticipated, unbound generosity? I add this notion of conversionary space to the others factors I have mentioned above as being one of the particular fruits of reading, because I think it fits so nicely with the image I have presented to you, as reading providing, so St. Augustine would teach us, with a fig tree of one's own. In the lectures that follow, I am going to be developing just how and why literature provides readers with their own personal fig trees, those spaces in which the written word can change a human life. As we make our way through the literary worlds that follow, we will often return to the goals of this course, the distinctions between casual and close reading, the terms and techniques of professional reading, and an exploration of the way that literature thinks differently from other modes of writing and human expression. I will also return to the other principles I mentioned in this introductory lecture on those things that good readers, serious readers, often share. How reading is a passport to alternate worlds, how it's a place where form and content can become one, how it functions as humanity's diary. I'll do this by detailing the processes, tools, and skills that go into reading. We will be meeting many fascinating authors and books along the way. With all these ideas in mind, I'd like us to begin our journey with what I think to be one of the most solid foundations of the reading experience, the world of metaphor.
This ends Lecture 1, The Art of Reading. Lecture 2, Mind of Metaphor.
What is a metaphor? How is it central to literature? What should readers expect to look for in it and with it? In the Oxford American Dictionaries, metaphor is defined thusly: a figure of speech in which a word or phrase is applied to an object or action to which it is not literally applicable. Example, I had fallen through a trapdoor of depression, said Mark, who was fond of theatrical metaphors. It's also defined as, quote, a thing regarded as representative or symbolic of something else, especially something abstract. And with the example, the amounts of money being lost by the company were enough to make it a metaphor for an industry that was teetering. Those are the dictionary examples, the dictionary definitions. They're, of course, true and accurate. But in literature and in reading, metaphor takes on what I like to believe are special powers. It has a capacity for saying one thing to suggest another. It also exists in relation to other metaphors and networks of figurative language. The attention it draws to literary language itself and literary images remains one of the defining aspects of the reading experience. In this lecture, I'm going to focus on one specific metaphor that I've written extensively about. It's that of the falling leaves, to suggest how a single figure of speech joins writers throughout the centuries in a common metaphor that pronounces on some of the most enduring questions of human life, yet at the same time, we remain firmly anchored in the force and in the power of literary expression. In other words, the metaphor has meaning, larger meaning and implications, but it also needs to be examined for what it literally says within the text. Let's work backward, since this is the way that writers themselves often work. They will look back to the history of literature for an image or a trope. Trope is a fancy way of saying kind of figure of speech, and then allude to or gesture toward this source in order to imbue their own work with the textures and themes of the earlier work. This is especially the case in the metaphor I'm about to describe, as it has an ancient history of Homeric provenance. Let me take you back to the source by starting with a text closer to our own day, one that I discussed in my first audio course in Michelangelo's Shadow, The Mystery of Modern Italy. Now, in that audio course, in our discussion of the relationship between language and money, especially as it related to Italy's drive for a single currency with the ascent of the lira in 1860.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.